Functions that are basic service delivery functions that are critical to the common man in the area of healthcare, in the area of agriculture and livestock, in water, in basic trade, rural roads, you name them. But the amount of funding that we get out of the total budget in 1 year works to about 9 to 10% of that year's budget, and about give or take 13, 14, 15% of the shareable revenue, which is usually based on the last audited accounts.
So we must keep asking that the constitutional threshold of 15% of total shareable revenue is released to the counties using not only the most recently audited, but the current. Because it's also sad that in 2024, we are still talking about 2019 accounts.
These are the governors of Wajir and Nyeri County respectively speaking about what they think about containing the wage bill. And of course, you can feel that the challenge is the denominator. What revenue are we talking about? It continues to raise several questions there. And Dr. Makali Mulu, tell me about, because as you listen, you hear the differences in salary structures across the different arms of government. You're talking about the judiciary, the Parliamentary Service Commission, of course, the Public Service Commission, but also in the counties. What then shall we do? Because you realize that disparity is real. Is it even a possibility that you have people who are doing almost the same tasks when you know that there's independence of the judiciary, there's independence of parliament?
I think to me the common denominator is that all these people are being paid from public resources. It is our taxes which are paying all public officers and state officers. And I think the reason why we have this commission called the Salaries and Remuneration Commission was basically to be able to harmonize all these structures. So, for example, if I'm working in judiciary as an accountant, and I'm working in parliament as an accountant, and I'm working in the executive as an accountant with the same qualification, or in the same job group, it could be, you know, some areas I will not say job group, but they call them other, they can give them any name. But so long as you have the same qualification, you are an accountant, why would you be earning a different salary and you are being paid by the same, you are getting money from the same source? Mm-hmm. That is the public coffers. So I think the thing is, SRC, to me, the way I look at it, as a lot of work to do. Because they are the ones who are supposed to be advising the three arms of government in terms of pay. The other problem I see is after then, because what they should do is the handover should be informed from analysis, very scientific analysis of what is happening. And basically, what we call the job evaluation. And I think they have experts in their own arrangement who can do that. Mm-hmm. So the thing we should be saying is, but do we have the goodwill to go by their figures? For example, me and Speaker here, they have always advised what should be paid to members of parliament, what allowances. But you can see the level of resistance. Mm-hmm. And because of the political issues around the salaries, even the political class might not be willing to antagonize all these groupings because these are voters. So there's an element of also the politics of it. If you are to reduce the salaries of people, or if you are to sack people today, what would happen to your politics? And to me, these are the difficult issues. The other challenge I see, and they must address it, if you look at the structure of the civil service now, and these things have been discussed every day, we're having issues of succession management. You find we have at the top, around between 50 and 60, you have a very big group there. Then in the middle, you have a no group. Then you have others at entry level. So you find the way to manage the succession is also another issue. So the question is, when you say you sack people and you want to suspend employment and still you have a challenge on how to manage succession. So this is another problem which must be addressed by the SRC. The other matter which I think the matter my colleagues were discussing earlier, the issue of allowances. I agree with them. The issue was to manage pension because pension is pegged to the basic pay, so that my basic pay determines how much pension I should earn once I leave employment. And what has happened over time then so many allowances have been brought on board to a level that there are Kenyans who earn more allowances than the basic pay. And that is a serious problem, because at the end of the day, I think the proposed should be is that your allowance should be a maximum of about 40% of your basic pay. But there are people already earning over 100% of their basic pay. So that's another area which SRC must address. The other problem which I see in this country, and I think it's an area we must also address, and this is more of a political hot potato. Anybody who gets elected to a political office, that is the governors, the ministers, the president, the deputy president, they come with a group under the, they call them advisors. There's something called advisors. I don't know, you might wonder what they advise on. But so long as you're in that category, advisors, if you look at the kind of money they earn, it's also a lot of money. And that is not determined.
Nobody controls that.
I don't know whether SRC, as part of their mandate, should be controlling that, because the way I look at it is like a political rewarding. You know, we've worked with you in my political journey. Now I've been elected. Come and join me, and in joining me, I can give you any salary I decide. And I think that is very common, and that has been made worse by the county governments, because every county has a governor,
okay,
who also has a chain of advisors. While the law says you can have not a maximum of about three or four. You find some of them are even 10 advisors. If you do analysis, you can find a lot of advisors. So to me, I think that if we are serious as a country, if we are serious, we can easily sit down and clean this payroll by doing two important things. One important thing is to ensure that what the law provides for in terms of numbers, if it is four, we restrict them to four. If it is 10, they must be restricted to 10. That's one area. The other thing we need to do is We help this issue, the debate on wage bill, by then harmonization. So that if I'm an economic advisor to my deputy speaker here, I'm an economic advisor, and then I'm an economic advisor to Senator Biro, at the end of the day, we earn the same salary, and we also earn the same allowances. So that by harmonization, then you also clear a lot of these, you find you can easily get the figures right. But in a situation where you go to judiciary, you find an economist in judiciary earns three times or one and a half times an economist in the public service, and they are all went to the same class, they all got their degrees at the same time, then what you are seeing automatically is then you attract people to move from the public service to the judiciary, and every time the public service will be blowing new economies, while judiciary will be getting the most experienced one. And that is happening in many organizations. For example, the ESCC, when we set up the ESCC, a lot of lawyers and a lot of serious Kenyans moved to the ESCC. Like now, Parliament attracts a lot of employees from the other two arms of government, because I think salary structure in Parliament is slightly higher than the other arms. So we need that harmonization. By doing that, we hope this country, and we'll also reduce the wage bill.
One quick one. Yes. You know, the other thing, which two things which are critical here is the perception in the 80s, you know, and in the 70s, that public service in Kenya are lower paid than the private sector. And the government kept on adjusting. Today, public sector pays more than the private sector in many respects. The second is that because of the government, especially at the executive level, trying to attract technocrats, they create a lot of disparity. You hire this guy from World Bank and this one from IMF, and you pay him three, four, five times what another career public servant is earning. You know, that also created. Today, it still happens, by the way, from the time of the Dream Team in Moi up to Kibaki, Uhuru. Up to now, that arrangement is also there. And then the question of the unionizable employees, the CBA arrangement, which is part of the reasons why, again, doctors, for example, teachers, and some people, you know, have an opportunity to negotiate their pay because of that. So there are a lot of factors, really, for SRC to look at. But at the end of the day, I still believe the political will up there is critical for SRC to perform.
And what are your thoughts? Because I'm looking at Article 230 of the Constitution, sabbatical, this should be four, on the powers and functions of the SRC. Of course, set and regularly review the remuneration and benefits of all state officers, and then advise the national and county governments on the remuneration and benefits of all other public officers. Does that statement also include the public service, I mean, the Parliamentary Service Commission and the Judicial Service Commission, knowing that those are two independent arms of government that have their own independent commission? Where does the SRC stop in such a manner?
You see, when we set up that thing in Bomas, in the constitution, the spirit of it was that all of them would be guided by, would come under SRC, the Public Service Commission, Judicial Service, all of them. That was the. But I think when it came now to working, and you know, when they started looking at, for example, when they did the first job evaluation of parliamentarians, and they said, you know, based on a job evaluation, this is what parliamentarians should be earning. We said, what are you talking about? That's not your mandate. We have a Parliamentary Service Commission. So then, you know, under Chapter 15, there are several other commissions that said we are also independent. But I think the spirit was very clear that SRC would play that role across the entire public service, and that would, by implication, you know, include judiciary and the parliament. That is the way it was intended. But in terms of people went to court, I think they went to court eventually, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so. But that was the intention, really. Yes, it's supposed to have been.
So, Deputy Speaker, when you are able to raise the remuneration for judicial officers, am I allowed to call them that?
Yes.
By 400%, which is by four times, was there input from the SRC or it was not necessary?
I remember we wrote an opinion to the SRC at that time, and we said they can advise the Judicial Service Commission. But if you're supposed to advise me, I can take your advice or not take it. And we decided not to take the advice.
And that's where the problem is.
Yeah. So.
What was the advice like?
We just ignored the SRC because we had a challenge at that time.
Yeah.
We had a very big problem. We had people who were degree holders and working in the registry and earning 11,000 shillings. And people preferred to stay there because then they would be selling court dates, selling hearing dates, and so on. So we realized that it was important that we actually remunerate people equally to what they deserve to be earning. We also had a very big disparity that the judicial staff, were not considered as people who are qualified. It's only the legal profession that was being considered at that time. And we changed it, and we were able to, we just told SRC we wouldn't take your advice.
So then you're saying that, because I think the salaries for judges who are state officers are determined by the SRC.
Yes.
For the other officers who would be the public servants within the judiciary, you're saying the SRC does not have a mandate in determining how much they should take?
The SRC can review the workload, evaluate, and then recommend and advise the Judicial Service Commission.
That advice is not binding?
That in the judiciary, it wasn't binding.
So then how
and we managed to proceed without them.
How then do you harmonize and control the wage bill if we are to use all the constitutional provisions that have been put?
I think what was happening at that time is that the judiciary were really low, very poorly paid. That was the challenge.
No, I get that. I'm just talking about now moving forward because we are where we are, and the reality is that 47% of revenue is going to the wage bill. How then do you harmonize across the three arms of government?
I think what happened is, during the Bomas talks of the new constitution, we instituted the Salaries and Remuneration Commission.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't go back and break down the structures that already existed. So we still find that you have the Public Service Commission that continues to, you know, deal with human resources in the public service. You have the Judicial Service Commission that deals with the judiciary. Mm-hmm. Then you have the Parliamentary Service Commission that deals with parliament. So we didn't break the other structures. We just added a new structure called SRC. And then if you see, it's even gotten worse now. In the counties, every county has a public service board. So we have mini public service boards in every.
But I would imagine their work is now is to recruit.
They recruit.
To first of all, establish how many staff you need.
Yes.
Go ahead and do the
recruit
process.
And then even decide on how much pay.
Based on advice from the SRC, no?
SRC.
They are supposed to follow the SRC guidelines. But if you look at it, in fact, the challenge that we have with the doctors at the moment, it's because you find that a doctor with the same qualification in County A and County B don't earn the same amount. That's one of the complaints that the doctors have at the moment. It's not equal pay for equal work. It's different. And this has to be harmonized. So we added another system on top of an existing system without breaking the old system.
So tell me, your reading of Article 230, what should be SRC's role?
SRC should be able to give guidelines. But...
To who?
Sorry?
To who?
To anybody who's working in the public service or state officers, they should be able to give guidelines on the pay. But unfortunately, we also, each of those state organizations have their own little SRC. So you find that the Judicial Service Commission will come up with recommendation on what the salary should be for judges, for the judicial staff working there. Then you go to County A, County B, everybody has their own public service board. You go to the Parliamentary Service Commission, same thing. And it has caused such discrepancy that you find the other day, many of the people who work at the Directorate of Public Prosecutions, for example, will move to Parliament or they will move to the judiciary because they pay better.
Yep.
That's why we have a very big attrition rate at the state law office, because they are poorly paid compared to the other arms of government. And that's why there has to be an intervention to actually relook at it. And I think at the time when, during your time, you had the task force to review and try and harmonize all this. It's about time we did that again. Mm-hmm. So even if SRC keeps talking and saying this is what should happen, we should use the wage bill, what we should be looking at is first harmonizing so that the advice comes from one central place, which is SRC.
Okay.
But right now, SRC is not in control.
You see, we now have the bombers. the bombers moment in Parliament where the constitution is up for review. If this is a critical thing to the government, it's the best time for the government to bring it up and amend it and give the powers to SRC.
Mm.
It doesn't need a referendum. In fact, it's give powers to SRC so that it can, its guidance becomes obligatory, or you know, to other commissions that are responsible for.
And actually, I think from what you're saying, Sam,
that is the way to do
the article you're reading is very clear. Matters remuneration should be determined by SRC, so that the other boss should take care of the other HR issues. For example, with salary, we know that if you are working for judiciary, parliament, whatever salary you earn will have been determined by SRC through a very scientific analysis of what you do. And I think that's what we are missing, that that was the spirit. But we are not living that spirit because of the political issues, because of independence issues, because every time we claim we are independent, so you should not determine even what do our workers. And I think that's the challenge we have.
And you see, Dr. Makalimulu, the strange thing here is that Deputy Speaker says that the SRC can advise, but it is up to the Judicial Service Commission to decide whether to take the advice or not. The SRC has advised that medical interns should get 70,000 and not 206,000 shillings.
Mm.
Why should the government heed that advice? Because now the government is busy saying that this is the only thing that we can afford, and it is based on advice by the SRC. I mean, then it sounds like almost double standards.
Yeah, double speak. Mm.
See, in developed countries, even a constitutional institution gives advice, legal advice.
Mm.
It's binding. You cannot, as another state entity, ignore an advice given by a legal entity provided for in the constitution. But in this country, the Supreme Court can give an advice and it's ignored. SRC can give and it's ignored by this one. It's a practice that.
But I'm also wondering,
not really,
Bill,
it's unfortunate.
If the intention was to make SRC determine an advice on salaries inclusive of the judicial, so, or those officers that work in the judiciary, those that work in the Parliamentary Service Commission, and they are not state officers, why wasn't it put clearly here in the Constitution?
No, you see, the Constitution is very clear. It gave the mandate to SRC. But
But it's saying 4B is advise the national and county governments on the remuneration and benefits of all other public officers. Does national government include Judicial Service Commission and the public Parliamentary Service Commission?
Yes, you see, when we talk of national government and county government, in that context, national government includes all of those institutions, Parliament, judiciary,
the three arms.
All the three arms are included as national government.
So where didn't it say that the advice shall be binding?
No, you see, but that is the thing. That's what, not only this, if you look at the CRA, revenue allocation, every institution that is supposed to give advice, in legal terms, is always put in that context. Mm-hmm. But the fact is that it's supposed to really be binding in other countries. I know, for instance, when you look at India or similar countries, this kind of advice is binding on them. They're not there just for the keeps. You're just writing things and then somebody can throw in the dustbin. No, that's what it means. But I think in ours, like in everything else, we need to put everything in letter, not just in spirit.
You know, as you speak, there's an active matter in court where someone has taken SRC to court in regards to advice on what allowances should go to judicial officers, including, is it a car allowance or is it an official car? That matter is active in court. Mm-hmm. And the argument is that the Judicial Service Commission should be the one to determine the working conditions, not the SRC. We'll need to hear about the outcome of that. But feedback from Kenyans at Citizen TV Kenya, Sam Gituku, the hashtag to use is Daybreak. What are they saying? So that we can sample a few of them. Lillian CEO is saying that President William Ruto is trying as much as he can to manage our country's expenditure with a keen consideration of our revenue growth and wage bill status. I am certain we will strike a good balance under his watch. Godi Baraza Were, President Ruto's administration should re-examine the government expenditure, especially on the wage bill, and significantly cut down on unnecessary spending. The salaries of some officers in some commissions should be slashed to pay doctors. Okay. Frank Orinda, we must agree that workers must be paid well. They are the drivers of the economy. Having said that, SRC should do their work well, independently. What we have been seeing is external influence, and as a result, SRC ends up in conflict with workers' unions. And Team Kenya is saying that let us be genuine. For us to reduce the wage bill, we must tackle our overrepresented national and county assemblies, a crowded executive, and ghost workers. How can 3,000 people consume half of our budget? We must be deliberate on this. Okay, Engineer Lazaro is saying that the government should come up with the well-laid-down structure of hiring employees from the counties to national level. If not, politicians will still create positions for their supporters. Every county should be given expenditure limit. And Charlo Woodrose, salaries in Kenya should be rationalized. It doesn't make sense when some people are overpaid than others. The underpaid staff are more overworking. The underpaid staff are overworking than the overpaid staff who are at the same time enjoying huge allowances. It is not fair at all. That's what you're saying this morning. And I want us to transition to the conversation of the economy. The president is saying that a lot of things are now coming to settle. Let's listen to him.
Leo ile bei ya unga ilikuwa 200, saa hii karibu na karibia 100. Dola ilikuwa imefika 160, saa hii iko hapa 120 something. Na bado mafuta ndio ile ilikuwa pale, mumeona hata leo imeanguka na shilingi 10 just today. Because we are making the right decisions. We are not making popular decisions. In leadership and in service, we must always make the correct decisions, not the popular decisions. We must make the correct decisions every time. That's how we are going to take Kenya forward. Zile inchi ambazo ziko mbele yetu walitutangulia, leo wamekomesha umaskini, leo watu wengi wao wanafanya kazi, leo they are industrialized, they have made progress. It is because they made the right decisions and leaders led from the front.
All right, that is the president speaking about what is happening. And the oil prices dropped, I think it was on Sunday. And a litre of petrol is now 5 shillings cheaper, a litre of diesel 10 shillings cheaper, a litre of kerosene 18 shillings cheaper. The dollar now is below 130 shillings against the shilling. Senator Kero, talk to us, because we've had this conversation before about what has been happening. Once upon a time, there was that promise that the dollar would be dropping to about 115 shillings. It did otherwise. Now it's dropping, and there's a bit of acknowledgement. What exactly has happened?
Well, I don't think there's any dispute on the numbers he has given. The prices of food going down, the dollar going down, and the petrol prices have gone down. What we may not agree on, and what are the reasons behind it? Is it government decisions that are responsible for that, or other factors? For example, in the question you've asked on the dollar, I think a lot of reasons have been given. But I think what I know for a fact is that the euro is one. We were able to get a new euro bond to pay the one that was maturing. It did create a bit of confidence in government, and that was part of the reason. There's a significant uptick also in loans from IMF, World Bank. Significant inflows of foreign currency into the country. Third, I know there is a substantial inflow of foreign investors taking up bonds, and even Kenyans selling off their dollars and going for the government securities because of the very high interest rates. Government securities had reached 18%. So it makes no sense for you to have your money in dollar when you can invest in that 18%. And when the infrastructure bond was released, it was going at 18%. And so that also was part of the reason why the people cashed their dollars and went for that. So I think those are some of the factors. But if you ask me on the fundamentals of the economy, on the balance of payments, on the imports and exports, this did not change significantly. I don't think there is a slowdown in imports because of the very high cost of business in the country. I'm in business. I know everyone has reduced their import of raw materials because of the high cost of taxes, the low demand because of the high, and so forth. So, yes, imports are a bit low because of that, but not for any other reason. But exports have not gone up significantly. We had challenges in coffee industry. We had challenges in tea. You remember in the past, just improved in the last 2 months or so. So I think that those financial reasons, and of course the central bank also focusing their monetary policy on raising the interest rates, ostensibly to fight inflation, but to also attract money, because for their bonds and bills and so forth, but to also, bring down the shilling, because the more they raise the rates of interest and these bonds and bills and everything became very attractive, the more money, the more demand for the shilling. And so I think, yes, so it did. Whether that was a deliberate action by the government or not is contested in the way I've said. But otherwise, yes, the shilling has gone up significantly, and I think that has helped in the government reducing the petroleum prices. In the last 2 months, from February to April now, the shilling has appreciated by nearly 20%. Fuel prices, not of course by the same amount, but almost by 12-13%, they have reduced in the last. And the reduction in fuel is purely because of the dollar, really. There's no other incentive by the government. They have not reduced taxes or removed any of the levies or any of the things. It's just the dollar, really. So if today, for whatever reasons, because of the war in the Gulf or the Middle East, petroleum prices go up, generally, the international oil prices have also been more or less stable. But should anything happen and they go up, it will be difficult for the government unless they come up with something now in terms of reducing some of those taxes or levies. The forex thing that has reduced the prices will not work. So I think the government has to be very careful to claim credit for some of the things, because if it does, then tomorrow, if the reverse happens, then they'll be under pressure to try and do something also.
And so when all these things are happening, what then is the assessment of the economy? Is it improving? Is it stagnating or retrogressing?
Well, you see, the economy is not all about just getting, overnight. In the last February 15th to now, the dollar changed and so the economy has improved. No, the economic situation is still pretty bad. And I think this is why, of course, I'm not in government, but government likes to give different perspectives on different circumstances. Even doctors want money, the economy is bad, but when there's something else they can say it's good. But the fact is, the economy, if you talk to the ordinary Wanjiku and the ordinary people out there, the situation is not better because the cost of living is still pretty high for them. Things are expensive, life is still difficult. Business is very bad. If you talk up to the manufacturers, if you talk to many of the businesses, they tell you things are pretty bad. I mean, the demand is low. I think the shilling has helped, yes, but the effect would come in the next few months if it's sustained. Because 1.5 months, really, of the shilling appreciating. For me, for example, in my business, to import even my raw materials, the delivery, it can take even 2 months. So the effect would be seen later. So I think if it's sustained throughout the year, yes, it would have an impact, particularly on the cost of production. Of goods that rely on, and that also the downward review of the prices of oil also continues, yes, then it would, both of them would have an impact. But the significant thing really for the ordinary Wananchi is the cost of food, and this because of the weather improvement. You remember in the last 3 years or so of Uhuru, we had severe droughts.
Right.
Luckily, this government, the last 2 years, the weather changed dramatically, and there's plenty of rain. And so the farmers, with the help of the fertilizer, the weather particularly, I think things are looking upward for the, for especially in the food, in the food sector. So if it continues, yes, you can say yes, the economy is now on the right track. But sustainability of this, of the forex, of the petroleum prices is critical.
Right.
It's critical.
Sustainability. Deputy Speaker, what would be your explanation to what is going on? Because there are those that say, yes, there could be because of the decisions that have been taken by the government. But also, the fuel is still not where it was, because on swearing-in day, on the day of inauguration, it was at 159 shillings to a litre of petrol. Now it's 193, still higher than where it was. So what is your account of what has happened?
My account of what has happened in improving the economy has been because of deliberate steps. I was part of President William Ruto's campaign, and I know that as he campaigned, he was preparing himself for what exactly he needed to do to transform Kenya. So people like David D, Augustine Cheruiyot, and all the other economic advisors were already working before he was elected on exactly what he needed to do when he gets into office. So it's not by mistake. I can see it. It's exactly as he designed it. He came up with a plan. He knew what we need to do to bring the cost of living down. He knew that we had a challenge with the we were importing too much as a country. And he says, we need to have a plan how to reduce our imports and increase our exports. So it's been deliberate steps. It's not by mistake. Mm. I watched it. I saw him make a plan of what he's going to do when he becomes president. So by the time he became president, he had designed what he needed to do. And I can see that he's actually each and every one of those. He's ticking each and every one of those boxes.
And that plan included some heavy dark phase that Kenya.
Yes. If you remember when the deputy president spoke in Kasarani, he said we have inherited a country where the granary is empty. We have a difficult time. So there was no pretension about it. It was clear that yes, we were inheriting a dilapidated economy. But this is what we need to do to turn it around. And difficult decisions had to be made. Fuel subsidies were being put there, but it was a band-aid just being put on a wound but not dealing with the issue. So the changes of saying no subsidizing fuel anymore, no subsidizing unga, that was being said, that was being done. But let us now subsidize production, which has got to do, you've seen what has happened with the fertilizer. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you subsidize production. It was clear. It was a difficult decision. People were not happy about it at the beginning, but eventually it has paid off, and it is going to pay off.
So are the coffers full now?
No, but we are on the road to recovery.
No, I'm asking that because, look, it was said we have inherited empty coffers. Recovery would mean there's something in the coffers. governors have complained about disbursement of resources. There has been delays in certain operational costs for different agencies in government. So there appears to be still a serious challenge. The revenue collection is a challenge. The Kenya Revenue Authority's targets are not being met.
Yes, and if you change after the finance bill, in order to be able to see any change, it will take a full financial year to be able to see the changes. So I think also you don't expect it to happen overnight. So we will begin to see the change, and that's why I told many people, it may be a little difficult now, but are we on the road to recovery? Are the right decisions being made to ensure that we make changes to our economy? The answer is yes.
Okay. Dr. Mulu, are we on the path to recovery?
Thank you, Sam. You know, Sam, listening to the president, he has done what a good politician would do. And me and Shuleya, we are good politicians. Good politicians take advantage of situations. The second thing is that what has happened, mm-hmm. Sam, mm-hmm. is good for Kenyans. It's a huge relief for those Kenyans who have been saying we're actually dying. But looking at it now from the economic point of view, I think the factors which have contributed to what has happened mostly are external. Other than the food prices, where what I would call the gods have been in favor of what is happening, that we've gotten very good rains, then with the fertilizer intervention, we got very good harvest. Basic principle of demand and supply has pushed the prices down. God is still blessing us with a lot of rains this year. And my expectation is that we will still continue seeing the food prices going down if the fake fertilizer does not change the situation. And what will happen is that the food inflation is actually improving. Mm-hmm. It's doing very well. And that's why you see our general inflation is coming down. But what has happened for me, externally, I would call it what I call a dollar magic. What has happened is what Honorable Bilo has summarized. Mm-hmm. As a result of the dollar appreciating, no, the shilling appreciating, a dollar and the dollar depreciating from 1.6 to 1.27, a number of things have happened. Any transaction which was in terms of dollar has realized a positive gain.
Right.
That's why you see the price of fuel is coming down, not because this government has done anything, just because that component of what you call the forex has changed. And it has changed in favor of the Kenyan economy. Mm-hmm. So, but what we are saying is, even though it's good to celebrate that achievement as a government, they have to be very cautious. Because if you look at the geopolitics currently, what is happening in Israel and Iran and the other international politics, my fear is if anything happens and then the issue of the dollar going up again comes up, then this price will have to shoot up again. I don't know what they'll do to stop them from going up. And that's why I think we are saying they need to be very cautious, because it means then if they have to continue celebrating as a government, then they'll have either to subsidize that extra cost, which is likely to come as a result of that. The other thing has happened is also, if you look at the international interest rates, actually, the main economies, mm-hmm. like US, UK, interest rates now are coming down. You know, they've been pushed up to control inflation in those economies. Now, when the interest rates come down those economies, what happens is you have more dollars flowing to our side, because now investment in Kenya becomes more attractive for any foreigner. So we are getting more dollar inflow to our side. Mm-hmm. And that's why you see the foreign exchange is stabilizing. And I think we are not factoring, and I think it's important to factor in, is the issue of remittances. If you look at now the money coming from outside by Kenyans pushing to Kenya, mm-hmm. Even the paper, The Nation, yep. the last page is saying it has increased by 19%.
Right.
And actually the other day we were analyzing and we are realizing that now the remittances from Kenyans outside there is becoming a major, almost kind of a factor in terms of inflow of dollars to our country. So these are some of the factors which have contributed to what we are seeing. Mm-hmm. But we are saying they could also be very short-lived. So in short, I'm saying the fundamentals in terms of economic issues have not changed much. And that's what we are saying, what Kel was saying, the issue of, if you look at our exports, our imports, you look at the issues of what I would call the macroeconomic factors which determine the growth of an economy, those ones have not changed much. And that's why we are saying we still have a long way to as a country, still movement.
You call it dollar magic. And before this administration came to office, or actually after they came into office, they were claiming that there was propping of the shilling. This appreciation of the Kenya shilling, is it organic or it's artificial?
No, what happened is, you know, and that's why really I wonder why what happened? You know the issue of the Eurobond. We had to borrow $1.5 billion. Now, that was a huge injection. And what had happened, some people had actually, there was holding of dollars.
Yeah.
People were saying, by the time you pay this amount by June, you have to buy dollars from Kenya. So some people had actually taken dollars from the banks and another source and kept them, speculating that come June, we'll be able to sell these dollars at around 200,000. Mm-hmm. Now, what the government did, they borrowed the $1.5 billion to have an advance payment of the Eurobond, and that caused what I would call panic sale. So people had kept their dollars, hoping that by June I'll sell at 200, realized that things now have changed, and I have to lease my dollars to the market, otherwise I'll lose big. That's what you saw now, from 1.6 to 1.27.
But why is that not reflecting in the foreign exchange reserves?
But how did it reflect that it was just internal? People were just sold dollars to the banks. And it's the issue of supply and demand. But you know what is very worrying, and that's why I, as an economist, I get worried when I see people celebrating, is because, you know, we borrowed to pay.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't borrow with our resources. So we only kicked the ball to move a bit ahead. Very soon it will catch up with us.
Okay.
To make things worse, the other one was about 10 years. Mm. Now this, I think, is about 7 or 6 years, something like that.
Starting,
so we'll have a shorter time to pay. So it's more that it's just a management. To me, is what they call, do they call it contingent liability management?
Mm-hmm.
It's like you're managing your abilities just in a kind of a temporary way, awaiting to because it will still catch up with us. Very soon it will catch up with us. But so it's short, Sam.
Mm-hmm.
It's a big relief to Kenyans, but let's move to the future. Don't be surprised if we go back to the issues, because the external factors are at play. You don't know for how long they will be sustained.
Okay.
In terms of...
You interested?
Yeah, I think, let me just add also to what Mheshimiwa said. Of course, the euro bond did not have an actual financial impact. It's not money that was flowing, new dollars that were flowing into the country. It's a borrowing to pay off an existing debt. But what mattered was that there was concern about the country defaulting, and so it helped on that confidence. But I think on the question, is this really dollar magic organic? Moesh has tried to avoid, but to many of us, we think it's not organic. With the CBK monetary policy, tweaking the interest rates in December, in February, really pushing it to 13% all the way, and offering, infrastructure bond going for 18%, treasury bills bonds going for 18%. That tweaking is significant in terms of the appreciation of the shilling, because if you had a dollar. And exporters had dollars. The question was not for lack of dollars in the country. It's about the people not wanting to sell their dollars because of concerns about the about the future. So now there was an opportunity. You can invest and make money. So I think that. So the moment I think the government starts reducing, the interest rates, it will have an impact on the shilling. That clearly, because we. That's why many people believe it's really not organic, to use your words.
Right. And so what happens then to revenue question? Because even when we're talking about the wage bill, there appears to be a serious issue in terms of how much you're able to collect. And then improvement of the economy should also see probably growing revenues, whether it's at the private level or at the public level when it comes to the national revenues. What is that path towards that?
No, you see, revenue is about the taxes. And the taxes are, it's all about the economy. The economy, we've said, is not really doing well. I mean, just because the shilling changed in the last couple of a few weeks, the economy is not out of the woods. So, and those in business will tell you, in the manufacturing, in generally in every sector of the economy, things are tough. And this is why KRA, in spite of the higher increases in taxes, is not able to collect more revenue. That's one of the reasons. The second thing is, if these things work that, for example, if the largest sources of revenue is in customs duties and VATs, mostly on our imports, and you'll find that in the past few months, the reason why we have had significant increases in those two is because of the higher cost of dollar. Because when you import, and your duties are paid based on that. So with now things going down, the shilling going down, the dollar value going down, I'm telling you, the imports inflow from KRA inflow from imports and VAT at the port of Mombasa will go down also because of that. Mm-hmm. But generally, the economy has not really significantly increased, and some of the taxes are a disincentive to business. And businesses have complained, manufacturers and everyone went before the parliamentary committee and said, look, this tax is fine, you want to bring in, yes, but it's going to cost more in terms of we're going to lay off employees, we're going to reduce our operations, it's going to affect customers, they're going to change how much they're going to buy, the consumption, everything will go down. So I think this is already the effect that we are seeing. We saw it in petroleum. For example, when the petroleum prices were increased, the demand went down and the volumes were clearly on a downward trend. And the same has happened in many sectors of the economy. So higher taxes, yes, they have served to be a disincentive. And those are some of the decisions that the government made, which they should say they're painful, yes, but they're not paying off up to now. They're not paying off. So I don't see how revenues will change significantly. I think KRA will continue struggling to try and make the ends meet. But the challenge, the other day I saw one of the headlines this week and said that, there are more revenues now being collected, there are more loans being collected, but development is still not there. But I think it's about priorities. The government also needs to significantly up its, on the issue of priorities. Because unless we do that, we will not get out of the woods.
Before we take feedback, Deputy Speaker, then, you see, we may talk here, and a lot of things may be said by the political class or the leaders. In the end, it is about the impact to Mwananchi. And in less than 100 days, Kenyans, especially those that are employed, will have to part with some 2.75% going towards social health insurance fund. The target is every other Kenyan, but that's the more efficient one. The affordable housing levy has come in, so meaning that the disposable income continues to decrease. And there's also talk that there should be no pay rise being processed by employers in the public sector. So essentially what you're talking about is that this disposable income remains low. The investments, as the two gentlemen are saying, is not, you're not getting the yields that you would expect. Business is not functioning as it should. So in the end, how then does Mwananchi feel the benefit of these efforts?
You know, Sam, I've been coming to these TV shows for a long time. And one of the issues that's always discussed is we try and look at all the negatives. Even when things are working and doing well, we still want to go back and say, but this is wrong and this is being done and so on. So let me tell you something, Sam. The economy has improved and we've seen it. And Kenyans are talking about it. The cost of fuel has gone down. The cost of electricity has gone down. The cost of the fertilizer subsidy is doing well and is paying off. Things are improving. Why don't we just be honorable enough to say the right things and the right decisions are being made and Kenya is on an upward trajectory? That's the reality. So maybe what you do is next year. So maybe what you do is because we are so obsessed about being negative. And it is something that I see in the Kenyan media. We just always don't want to ever admit that something is working and working right in our country. You're the ones who actually make people not want to invest in Kenya. So let's do this. Things have improved from where we were when I came here a year ago and 2 years ago. Right now, let us watch and wait and see what's going to happen. But so next year, call me here and you'll see things will have improved. Maybe you'll finally admit that things are working.
Nobody is disputing what you're saying. In fact, they started by acknowledging the difference in prices of fuel.
Yes.
And I am asking you, because in the end, it is about what is in the Kenyan's pocket. When do they feel that impact? That's the question that I'm asking, nothing else.
You know, the fact that we are paying extra housing levy, we are paying more for the social health insurance and so on, doesn't necessarily mean that there's less money in people's pockets. What it does is, like we said, affordable housing is creating employment. So there'll be more money circulating within the economy. So you're looking at it narrowly by just saying, oh, just because we are paying more for affordable housing, actually that money goes back into the Kenyan economy and into more people's pockets. So I may be paying more, but somebody else is going to get a job. And those people are going to have income to be able to go to the local kiosk, go to the market, buy, and the money will rotate around the economy. Yes. So it is more money in circulation.
Okay.
It's not going to another country. It's not like we're paying the extra tax for affordable housing and it's going to another country. It is in this country.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. All right. I want us to take a look at the feedback that has come in at Citizen TV Kenya. Sam Gitoko, the hashtag to use is Daybreak on this particular question of the economy. Kalu Leperio, the focus on reducing basic commodity prices and strengthening the Kenya shilling against the dollar is paying off. It is evident that the government's economic policies are yielding tangible benefits for the everyday citizen. This is a positive momentum. Engineer Lazaro, Kenya Kwanza regime should now learn to own all good and bad things in their government. This issue of claiming only positive results isn't going down well with the previous regime. What does that mean? Frank Orinde, how do you commercialize umaskini by poorly paying your workers? We must end double speak as well, if at all we really want to move forward. So I have a few seconds for the final remarks. Let me begin with you, Dr. Makali Mulu, especially if you can reflect on that question that I asked Deputy Speaker. She's not very happy with it, but I'm asking about when Kenyans begin to feel the impact in their pockets.
No, the truth of the matter, Sam, is that we are talking about economic growth, we are talking about things improving, and we agree some things have improved.
Yeah.
But what the concern of the common man is, nimesikia hiyo improvement mimi. Anytime I interact with the people, even in the streets here, they always ask me, simwambie Ruto anatumaliza. So, you know, they know I'm a leader. So anytime I meet them, simwambie Ruto anatumaliza. You know, just a casual talk in the streets. Anytime I go to my... So the thing is, mwananchi down there, and this is very common in most economies, not Kenya alone. We talk about economic growth, but the question is, to what extent does that growth go down all the way to the common person in the rural setting? And I think that's where you see the difference between economic growth and economic development. The issue of who benefits out of this growth. And I think with the corruption which Biro is talking about, most of this growth ends up benefiting very few Kenyans and not majority of us. So I wish that even as we grow the economy, we come up with a mechanism of making sure that money reaches all the way to the grassroots. And that's a challenge, actually, normally, with the issues to do with economic growth. But all said and done, God continues to be very gracious to us. The rains are with us. Let's make sure that the issue of fake fertilizer is addressed to the bottom of it. Because if we do as we did last year in terms of provision of fertilizer and with the good rains, we will continue bringing inflation down in this country. And it's good for the common mwananchi. But all said and done, we've given caution in terms of this is a worked. But you need to be cautious. When we say you need to be cautious, it doesn't mean we are opposing. We are saying be cautious as you trend, because normally there are things you must watch as you even move forward.
Okay.
Yes.
I think you've heard your final word.
I want to say a big congratulations to Helen Ombiri for winning the Boston Marathon.
Okay.
And also Sharon Dokedi and Edna Kiplagat, who took second and third position. I'm proud of them. Proud of you girls.
Yeah. Congratulations to them. And Senator Kero, your final word.
Yeah. I think the question you had put about the Mwananchi, ordinary Mwananchi, is very important. At the end of the day, many of us believe, and many Kenyans have expressed that same conviction, that very high level of taxes, whether it's on NHIF or whatever, all these taxes is not going to is a disincentive, really, and it does not help the economy. And many of us feel that it's really pushing the people down the poverty, down, because people are finding it very difficult to survive. So I think the government needs to rationalize and focus more on how to prioritize the expenditure, reduce the, rationalize the government, size of the government, reduce the expenditure, and avoid all these, you know, things we are seeing in the media about splashing money when people are really struggling to pay that kind of, you know, that kind of money to government.
All right, and thank you all. Dr. Makali Mulu from Kitui Central, Honorable Deputy Speaker at the National Assembly, and former Senator Bill Okeru, for making time for us to have this conversation. We'll continue to look into it, and this our time here on The Conversation on Daybreak. Up next is Matters Social with Safin Acheng Ouma. She'll be here with her crew. Stay tuned. Bye for now. My name is Sam Gitogo.